life in the world is that which is so minute that it is never seen without the aid of a microscope. It is of the utmost importance, for without it we would not have the edible fish in the sea, which forms such a valuable part of our food. Microscopic plants are eaten by microscopic creatures, who in turn are eaten by slightly larger creatures, and so on till our edible fish are fed. Here is some of this microscopic life from the coral seas of the Great Barrier Reef of Australia, and the methods of discovering them. A conical net with a glass test tube at the end is lowered overboard and then towed through the water. The net is made of silk. Seen through the microscope, this special fine silk looks as if made of coarse rope. These fine silken strands imprison the microscopic life but allow the seawater to filter through. Having been dragged through the water for some distance, it is then brought to the surface. The water drains out of the net, and the microscopic life is retained in the test tube. It is now emptied into a flat glass trough, where it can be examined with a high-power magnifying glass. If the catch has been good, the microscopic life appears like a fine dust drifting about in the trough. Under the microscope, one drop of this water on a glass slide reveals a new world. Here, those specks of dust are seen to be creatures of varied types. To them, this drop of water is as big as the ocean. Examine one more closely. These creatures are called copepods, which means feet-like oars, for they row themselves through the water. In another pot, but still in the same drop of water, is the cafeteria. The copepods dash in for a quick lunch and out again. Their method of feeding is strange. They lie on their backs and kick the food into their mouths with their feet, which work so fast that they appear like a paddle wheel, causing currents of water to carry the food to them. This is what it is eating. Diatoms. Microscopic plants. So small are they that hundreds heaped together would appear like a speck of dust. One diatom immensely magnified. Writing the Lord's Prayer on a threepenny bit is nothing to the detail nature engraves on a tiny diatom. The sea teems with microscopic worms. This one has legs like a centipede. Here the body is like the earthworm, but it grows tentacles from its head. If this worm were 100 feet long, it would make a first-class sea serpent. Actually, it is smaller than a pin's head, so sea bathing is still fairly safe. A baby starfish, so small it goes through the eye of a needle. When young, they do not crawl on the rocks, but float near the surface, where wind and waves carry them to new feeding grounds. This weird creature, the sea gooseberry, has combs projecting from its body, which it can use either to drive it through the water, or to create currents which will sweep the food into its mouth. It is a great fisherman, and catches the other microscopic life of the sea with fishing lines it can lower from its body. It is now unraveling the lines. They can be paid out many times the length of the body and are finer than the finest spider webs. Down they go, a nasty shock for any microscopic creature which may touch them. When first seen through the microscope, this queen creature was believed to be a new species and was named Zue. It is the baby stage of a crab, swims near the surface, and bears no resemblance to its parents. These creatures you have seen are called plankton and depend upon the diatom for existence. Without diatoms, the sea would be almost empty of life, from whales and fish to the oyster. Microscopic life is very prolific on the seaweed in the shallow pools which are left on the reef by the outgoing tide. A low-power microscope is used, and a small piece of weed with this fragile life adhering to it is cut off. The weed is now placed in a compressor, which presses the weed flat and squeezes the surplus water out, for less than a drop of water is a huge tank to these creatures. Imprisoned between two pieces of glass as thin as tissue paper, the seaweed is now put under the microscope. Fixed firmly to the weed is the home of a worm-like creature with a very beautiful head. It is a tubularian. Extremely shy, the slightest disturbance in the water causes it to shrink back into its shell. It spreads its plumed head as a net. Fine hairs growing from its head lash the water into tiny whirlpools, which help to sweep the food towards it. In early life, young tubularians do not resemble the parents. They are packed off to the surface, and the currents of the ocean then carry them where they won't eat mother out of house and home. Do flowers grow on seaweed? But this is not a flower. It is a hydroid, a microscopic creature which attaches itself by a stalk to the weed and spreads poison tentacles which catch its food. They don't care which way they grow, upside down or not. Microscopic life is found even at the bottom of the sea. A strong net with steel jaws which will tear weed and stones from their foundations is thrown overboard. The boat drags the net slowly along the sea bottom. Drawn to the surface, it is crammed with specimens. Every stone and weed has some form of tiny life adhering to it. A magnifying glass shows what appears to be a fragile plant growing from a stone. The sorae, very highly magnified. In these low forms of life, the line between the animal and plant kingdom is not very plainly drawn. These hydroid form colonies with branches, stalk, and even seed pods, an extraordinary resemblance to plant life. In these cases, the young are developed almost like seeds in a pod. But the tiny buds open and close unlike any flower. Those petal-like tentacles are loaded with poison and stretch out to catch the very minute life you can see swimming free in the water. Just look at this grotesque brute, for all the world like a spider monkey hanging by its tail from a tree. It is a ghost shrimp, a mere speck in size, and has its feet specially shaped so that it may cling to the branches of the hydroids where it feeds. It tears off one mouthful and grabs for the next. But the ghost shrimp is not going to have things all its own way. This jellyfish, here enlarged thousands of times its natural size, is quivering with excitement at the thought of shrimp for dinner. The jellyfish has captured one, and it is now lying inside it. See it struggling? It is not quite dead yet. This sea urchin came up in the dredge, and while not a microscopic creature itself, the spikes projecting from it have a wonderful microscopic structure. Thin slices of sea urchin spines of several types. A scientist with a microscope and portion of a spine can tell you the class it belongs to as accurately as a detective finds a person by fingerprints. Under a very high-powered lens, their beauty and structure is fully displayed. Here is a sea slug, crawling slowly through a shallow pool. It has probably laid its eggs on the coral nearby. Yes, here are the eggs attached to the coral. They are like a ribbon coiled in the shape of a flower. A small piece, a tenth of an inch square, will show hundreds of eggs in process of development. The microscope reveals a scene of busy activity. The eggs are packed so closely together that they almost touch. The higher powered lens gives a better idea of the structure of the egg ribbon and the enormous number of developing creatures. This is a single egg magnified millions of times. Each egg ribbon may contain 500,000 of these developing embryos. It's lucky they're not garden slugs. Imagine these in the cabbage patch. Inside the egg, the structure of the young slugs can now be seen. At such an early stage, they do not resemble their parents. They move by the aid of those fine hairs which lash so vigorously. Free at last, still a tiny speck, but growing more like mother every day. This sea slug carries its breathing organs outside its body, on its back. Fully developed. A glorious creature, red, gold, and fringed with white. Its breathing organs can be seen on its back. Imagine a man wearing his lungs like wings on his shoulders.